Good evening and welcome to Congressman John Sarbanes live telephone town hall. In order for everyone to hear tonight's call, you are in listen-only mode. That means you can hear me and the congressman, but we can't hear you. Tonight, we're holding a live question and answer session with Congressman Sarbanes. If you'd like to ask him a question, please press star 3 on your telephone keypad. Then, you'll be transferred to a staff member who will take your name and your question. Again, if you'd like to ask the congressman a question this evening, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad at any time, including now. I'm going to turn it over to the congressman for a brief opening statement.
Thanks very much, Dan. Hey, everybody. This is Congressman Sarbanes doing another in our series of many telephone town halls. As many of you know, this is something I've been doing from the first day I walked to Congress. I find it to be a very good way to connect with people, to hear directly from you, your concerns, your questions. It helps me immensely in terms of doing my job in Washington and in regard to the policy that I want to go fight for. But also, obviously, it helps inform our constituent service operation. We always want to be in tip-top shape with that and be very customer service focused, and these telephone town halls are a great way for me to stay connected and make sure we're at the top of our game. So I appreciate you all joining us this evening. We got about an hour to have a discussion. You can ask questions, make comments. I'll tell you right up front, if you have a question that you'd like to ask, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad. Tonight we're doing any topic that you want to talk about. It's sort of open phones. So if you've got a question now you want to ask on any topic, you can press star 3. We'll try to get you into the line to ask that question. Obviously, I want to observe a couple of things here right on the front end of the call. We continue to struggle through this pandemic. It's really a roller coaster ride for people around the country. Around the world, really, but certainly we're experiencing Americans, and the people in the third district that I represent are also having to count the impact of this virus, which is disrupting daily lives in dramatic ways. And of course, there's a lot of economic fallout that goes with that. So it's very important that we continue to point people to the assistance that's available, the economic relief that we've been trying to pass in Washington, make sure that gets to people out in the country and certainly to people in my district, but also to talk about the public health dimension of this, the guidance that's available, making sure we're listening to the professionals when it comes to how we contend with this pandemic. So I expect the questions on that this evening, and I look forward to that discussion. As many of you know, we passed the CARES Act, which was a big relief bill about 2 months ago. We also are trying to pass, actually it was a little more than 2 months ago, we're also trying to pass something called the HEROES Act, which would provide additional assistance to people across the country, families, frontline healthcare workers, small businesses, everybody out there who's in a very, very difficult position right now. So we can talk about that. And again, if you want to ask a question this evening, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad. We'll try to get to you as quickly as we can. Again, star 3 if you want to ask a question. I also encourage people to go to my website at sarbanes.house.gov. You can get good information there about the coronavirus response, about what's happening with these economic relief opportunities and assistance that's there, or any other question you have that relates to a federal agency. That's why I'm there. That's why we have that office. So I encourage you to reach out to us on our website. Again, if you want to ask a question tonight, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll try to get to you as soon as we can. There are some things happening right now that I want to call people's attention to because they're timely. One is that signing up for the special enrollment period for the Maryland Health Exchange for health care coverage if you don't currently have it. So I definitely want to encourage anybody who's been thinking about doing that but hasn't done it yet. Tomorrow is the deadline. You can go to MarylandHealthConnection.gov, and that's where you can get access to the information and enroll during the special enrollment period. There's also an opportunity to check a box on your Maryland tax return that will allow you to be enrolled as well. And, of course, those tax returns are due tomorrow in addition to the other deadline that I mentioned. So please take advantage of that opportunity. I also want to encourage people to complete the census questionnaire. You can do that online or you can do it through the mail if you haven't done it already. Marylanders are doing an okay job. We're at about 66%, I think, response rate, a little bit higher in the 3rd District, which I'm proud of, and higher than the national response rate, but still a long way to go because the census is really important. We want to have 100% of the people responding to that because that's really critical in terms of getting resources out to our communities. So I encourage all of you to take advantage of that. And then I'm sure we'll talk tonight about the coming elections in November, the steps you have to go through to make sure that you can vote. We want people to be able to access the ballot box safely, and there's different ways that you can do that. So if you want to talk about that topic, that's certainly fair game for this evening's call. Again, if you want to ask a question, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we will get to you as quickly as we can. Just wanted to mention some of the things we've been doing in Washington over the last couple of weeks. That's the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act, a response to the tragedy of George Floyd's death, but the continuing problem of police brutality across the country and steps that we need to take. We also passed a major infrastructure bill called the Moving Forward Act, and that would invest in, you know, $1.5 trillion in helping to build bridges and tunnels, repair our infrastructure, hospitals, schools, but also do it in a way that reduces carbon emissions from clean energy. So there's a way to boost the economy even as you're doing the right thing for the environment. So that was a very critical piece of legislation. So again, if you'd like to talk about any of these topics, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll get you in line to ask a question this evening. You want to talk about the pandemic? Obviously, that continues to be front of mind for people. What does the reopening look like? I know there's definitely a lot of concerns out there when it comes to the going back to school. What is that going to look like in August and September? Definitely concerns across the country and here in Maryland about that. What kind of progress are we making with treatments and vaccines? That's obviously an important topic as we try to address the coronavirus. There's a lot that needs discussion and focus. I do want to thank people on the phone, because I know you're taking precautions with your own families, in your own workplaces, as you go out into the public to make sure that we keep this infection down in Maryland. Maryland's done a pretty good job when you compare it to the rest of it. We can't take anything for granted. We have to stay vigilant. And I want to thank you being part of that solution. That's how we're going to get to the other side of this. So again, I think we're ready for our first caller, but if you'd like to get in line, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll try to get to you as well. Dan, why don't we get to the first question?
Our first caller this evening is Karen from Baltimore. Karen, you're on the line.
Oh, this is my first time experiencing this. My primary question is, I am very concerned. My grandchildren live in Anne Arundel County, and I'm very concerned about the safety of them returning to school under the president's dictates and Department of Education dictates. I have a second question is, I am very concerned about the fact that there is lack of funding to areas that have suffering so much as a result of the coronavirus. There is a total lack of funding, and we as taxpayers are, I think, paying double. And I'm sorry.
Thank you, Karen.
I appreciate it.
Don't apologize. Thanks for asking those questions, and I'm glad to have you joining the call tonight. I think you're echoing the concern that many have, many families, certainly many parents have, about what back to school is going to look like this fall. I join you in being very disappointed that the president and the Secretary of Education, Betsy DeVos, would be trying to bully systems around the country into when there continues to be risk and threatening to withhold federal funding. Now, you should know is that the Secretary of Education doesn't really have the authority to withhold funds in the way she's pretending to. But secondly, if there was ever something that deserved sort of local input and an assessment on a school system by school system basis or county by county basis, this would be it. The county executive, the school board in Anne Arundel County, they're going to have to make very careful judgments, as are the elected officials and the education officials in all of the jurisdictions in Maryland, and I'm privileged to represent five of them. But they're going to have to assess, based on what's happening with the coronavirus in their jurisdiction, what makes the most sense. Now, from my understanding, Karen, everyone is looking at basically three options. One would be opening schools, obviously trying to do it in a safe way, but bringing all the kids back on a regular schedule. Another option would be to keep everything online and remote. And the third would be some combination. I think a lot of these school jurisdictions are still assessing what makes the most sense. It's unlikely that any of the local jurisdictions I'm aware of here in Maryland are going to just reopen schools like they normally do, because obviously there's risks associated with that. But what combination of measures they put together to make sure that kids can get back into an education mode this fall and do so safely, I think they're still trying to assess that and gather information. So it's certainly something you'll want to consult with local education officials about, and I encourage everybody on the phone to do that. I can tell you we're trying to bring significant resources from the federal government to help schools across the country with this effort, including, you know, billions of dollars to help with buying personal protective equipment, cleaning and sanitizing classrooms, and other measures that can ensure that it will be safe for students to learn. But this is going to be a big challenge, and I know you share concerns of many on the phone tonight when you bring that issue up. As to your second point about making sure we get dollars to the people who really need them, that's been my priority from day one. I get very offended when I see that people who have kind of an inside track or special influence in Washington one way or the other can hijack some of these dollars that are supposed to be going. These are taxpayer dollars. They're supposed to be going to the people on the front lines who need them the most. Our healthcare workers, our delivery people, you know, the folks that are really out there in these essential jobs, but also getting to communities that have been hardest hit, like you just mentioned. So I'll continue to push for that. It's very, very critical. And it goes to the whole credibility of the federal government in terms of the way we get dollars out. There has to be accountability. There has to be transparency. And there has to be respect for the taxpayer and for the communities that are being hurt. So, Karen, thanks for that question. Why don't we get to our next caller, Dan?
Our next caller is Syl from Hanover. Syl, you're on the line.
Hi, good evening. Thank you for taking our calls. My question is about voting in November. I know that there are going to be protocols for the safety because of the pandemic, but specifically, what about voter suppression? What kind of safety protocols will be in place to protect voters, particularly voters of color, from voter suppression?
Well, I really appreciate that. One reason I appreciate the question is this is an issue I've been working on for a very long time in Washington. In fact, I was proud to author the For the People Act, H.R. 1, which was the first bill we introduced in this Congress. Last March, we passed it in the House. And a big part of that bill is to address voter suppression, because it's crazy that in America, after 200 plus years, that it's still so hard for people to access the ballot box. It shouldn't be hard to register, and it shouldn't be hard to vote. But unfortunately, in many places in this country, there are obstacles that have been placed in people's way, and we have to break those down. So I support efforts to address voter suppression. I support upgrading and improving the Voting Rights Act to make sure that it puts in place these very important protective measures. I definitely support, in this pandemic, having vote by mail. And I have to tell you, I have to say to everyone on the phone, I was very disappointed that the governor decided not to send a mail ballot to every registered voter in Maryland for the general election, like he did in the primary election. Because in the middle of the pandemic, I think people really want to vote by mail. Instead of receiving that ballot in the mail, they're first going to have to get an application in the mail, turn around, send that back in. That'll put a lot of pressure on local officials who have to process those applications. And that means the officials aren't going to be able to spend as much time figuring out how to open safe polling places for election day and early voting. So it's an inexplicable decision that the governor just made. I just don't understand. It doesn't make any sense to me, because it's going to make it harder for people in Maryland, not easier, for them to cast their vote, and potentially less safe for them to cast their vote. So to your point, we have to focus on this. The most important form of protest in a democracy, and certainly in American democracy, is the right to vote. And we have to make sure that we are preserving and protecting that right and clearing a path to the ballot box so that every American, every Marylander who wants to cast their vote, whether they're Republican, Independent, Democrat, that's not the issue. This is about patriotism and about your ability to act in your own democracy. They should be able to get to the ballot box and do so without that being a struggle. So thank you very much for that question. I appreciate it. If you're just joining us, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We are doing another in our series of telephone town halls. And if you'd like to ask a question, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad. Again, *3 on your telephone keypad. Any topic you want to ask about this evening is fair game. It's open phones. So if you want to talk about the pandemic, the economic challenges that we're facing, what's going on with our elections, as we just discussed, issues around the census and making sure you complete that, special enrollment in the Maryland Health Exchange. These are all important issues for Marylanders. And then, of course, what we're doing on Capitol Hill to try to help support people in this difficult time. And, you know, everybody's trying to play their part. I'm certainly trying to do that as a member of Congress. I benefit tremendously from hearing directly from people in my district, and that's why I value these calls so much. So if you want to ask a question, you can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll try to get to you as soon as we can. Dan, why don't we get the next caller?
Our next caller is Barry from Baltimore. Barry, you're on the line.
Hi. First of all, Congressman, I want to say the same thing I say every time I call your office, which is that I'm so deeply grateful you're my representative, particularly in these times. Everything that you've been covering is very important to me. I almost feel guilty having a personal issue, but I've been trying to get through to unemployment since the end of May. And your office is the only office that actually helped me, but that help went toward a phone call coming to me from the unemployment office that gave me a two-hour window to get back to them, of which I just wasn't available. I didn't get the message till after. They left me two messages within 2 hours with no place to call back, no person to talk to, and basically told me to get back into my attempts, which have been futile either via their website or phone. It's just a wall. And so that's the first part of my challenge. And the second is, having never applied for unemployment in Maryland before, I'm a theater artist and educator, so that means my market right now is zero unemployment. I'm going to probably have to stop paying my COBRA through my union, so that is going to probably put me into Medicaid here in Maryland, and I'm just wondering, am I covered in COVID situation, God forbid that happens, under Medicaid? I'm sure that's probably a question I could find out on some website somewhere. But first of all, it's really the unemployment thing is just, I'm not sure if I'm just supposed to give up. You know?
No, don't give up. Don't give up, particularly since we've been trying to help you to this point. We want to follow through and make sure we get this done for you. So what I'd ask you to do is get back in touch with my office as you did the first time. And we will try again to get you connected to the folks at the Department of Labor and Licensing in Maryland, which is the agency that is administering the unemployment insurance benefits. So we'll continue to work with you there. I know it can be a challenge, particularly for people in certain jobs and vocations. Some who are accessing this for the first time because their particular job didn't qualify before, gig workers, self-employed, and so forth. So there are new structures in place to try to assist people, but that has also led to some frustration for sure, and I can hear that in your voice. So please reach out to my office again, and we'll try to get this done for you. You know, as a general matter, I think that people are obviously being placed in a very, very difficult circumstance by this pandemic and the economic fallout that's occurring from it. And we're trying to get the best information to folks that we can to make sure that we can help them navigate this very, very difficult time. In terms of Medicaid coverage, I would encourage you to explore two things, the special enrollment opportunity through the Maryland Health Connection. You can actually sign up for that by tomorrow's deadline. At least go inquire with that, and you can go to MarylandHealthConnection.gov. I would encourage you to do that. I believe the exchange is designed so that it can either route you to the Medicaid opportunity that exists for you, if that's what you're eligible for, or to the other opportunities in the exchange itself. But that information should be available to you at the MarylandHealthConnection.gov. So please take advantage of that, because in this moment, clearly having healthcare coverage is very, very critical. Thank you, Barry. I appreciate your asking that question. It gave me a chance to talk about a number of important topics. Again, if you're just joining us, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We are doing another in our series of telephone town halls, my chance to hear directly from you on important issues and concerns that you have. I certainly welcome that. And so if you'd like to ask a question tonight or you just have a comment, you can press star 3 on your telephone keypad and we'll try to get to you as quickly as we can. If you have a particular issue you need help with from one of my caseworkers, you can call my office during daytime hours, 410-832-8890 at any time, again, during daytime hours, and we'll get back to you. You can always go to my website, sarbanes.house.gov. We have a lot of good information there, including some pretty good guidance on places you can turn with respect to navigating the coronavirus, accessing the important relief that we provided at the federal level, and also understanding what some of the guidance is coming from the state of Maryland and from your local counties. So I definitely encourage you to go to our website because we've worked very hard over the last few months to put together information that we think is really useful. And actually, I'm going to be getting that out to people in the mail as well because I think it's really important for you to have that. Dan, let's get to our next caller.
Our next caller this evening is Charles from Glen Burnie. Charles, you're on the line.
All right. Good evening, Honorable Sarbanes. I want to thank you for taking my question this evening and also give accolades to your office for a personal matter that they handled for me in the last week. My question, Senator Sarbanes, is that I have I've worked all my life from preteen on until retirement, but my question is that our Congress, our government in Washington, D.C., and elected officials, the authority that they do or do not have when it comes to executive orders coming from the White House and our constitutional laws that cover those things. It doesn't seem that if anyone is challenging those things, then they're just happening and the world is noticing this and it's quite embarrassing to everyone, I'm sure. And the second question I have was that the lobbyists, these are ongoing things. All due respect to the current situations that we're in, the lobbyists in Washington seems to be paying the way for all of our elected officials to get what they want, and that's a concern of mine. I hope you can address that. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, on the first question about executive orders, every president, this is just natural human nature. When you become president, you want to exercise as much executive authority as you can. So every president is drawn to the idea of executive orders. Some are more respectful of the fact that the Congress also has authority, the judiciary has authority. I feel like our current president sometimes acts like the executive branch is the only branch of government that we have and maybe is not as respectful of the Congress as he should be. Regardless of who the president is, it's important for the Congress to step up, push back, and make sure that its authority is kept in place. And that would be I say that on behalf of any member of Congress, whether they're a Republican or a Democrat, because the Congress, we call the House of Representatives the people's house. The Congress is the people's representative. And so asserting the authority of Congress is really asserting the authority of the people and saying to the executive branch, hey, you know, the people have rights. We have a stake in this democracy of ours, and we're going to push back when we think that makes sense. So I really appreciate you bringing that up. The second thing about how lobbyists have too much power in Washington, you're absolutely right. I've been fighting this from day one. I've never taken any PAC money for the last, I guess, 12 years almost, because I feel like there's too much money in our politics. And the people who give money in Washington, a lot of these lobbyists, the PACs, and so forth, when they give that money, they expect something in return. And it oftentimes is not what the public wants to see. It's some kind of special interest agenda that they have. In fact, Bob Dole, who was a Republican senator, you may remember him from years ago, he once said that if the lobbyists and the PACs get too much power in Washington, we'll never get anything done for the people. And he was right about that. So I'm very proud to be the author of H.R. 1, the For the People Act, which does all kinds of things to try to fight corruption in Washington and fix our democracy. But one of those things, Charles, is to set up a system of funding campaigns in America that's based on matching small donations. Because the idea then is that as a member of Congress or a candidate, I can power my campaign by turning to the people and collecting small donations and getting matching funds instead of having to go hat in hand to the lobbyists and the big money crowd. And the thing is, if you power your campaign with the people, you serve the people, which is the way it should be. And by the way we would pay for those matching funds is we would go take a little bit of money from settlements that these big corporate lawbreakers enter into with the federal government and put it into a special fund. So that way the people that have been leaning on our democracy and breaking it and disrespecting it, they'll be the ones to help pay to fix it. So that's how it should work in America. I'm going to keep fighting for that. I really appreciate you asking about it because it's an issue I feel very deeply about, as you can tell. Again, if you're just Congressman Sarbanes, we're doing another in our series of telephone town halls. Any topic tonight is fair game. You can press *3 on your telephone keypad. We'll get to you as soon as we can. Dan, let's get to the next caller.
Our next caller is Danae from Columbia. Danae, you're on the line.
Hi, good evening, and thank you so much for having this opportunity in the town hall to speak with you directly. And my question is really about workforce development and what you think that our game plan should be, or our approach across multi-generational and multicultural communities. And that's my
thank you. Thanks
question.
Very much. Uh-huh. I've worked on this quite a bit. Before I got to Congress, I spent many, many years working in education. I worked with the Maryland State Department of Education. I was focused on many jurisdictions in the state of Maryland, but particularly on Baltimore City. And I came to understand that we have to design our workforce pipelines in many different ways. There are those, obviously, who want to pursue higher education coming out of high school, to go to college, maybe get a higher education degree, a graduate degree. There are others who we need desperately in our workforce who may want to pursue apprenticeships coming out of high school, go to community college, and then go from there to other educational opportunities or into jobs. And we know that our community colleges, and Maryland has some terrific ones, by the way. I'm sure we got graduates of our community college system on the phone today. The community colleges are very good at anticipating where the next set of job opportunities are coming from and then designing instruction to kind of pivot in that direction. So they offer very, very good opportunities for people in terms of getting them into that workforce pipeline. So I think, you want your K-12 education system to be strong. We have to continue investing in that. That's why I supported the Kerwin Commission, which would put some serious dollars behind public education K-12 here in Maryland. You want to make sure you have a higher education system, so that includes the state system of colleges here in Maryland, as well as our community college system. And we also have some very good private universities here. But designing apprenticeships that kind of sort of vocational opportunities is also super important. If you look at countries around the world that have the strongest economies, and actually have the best opportunity for workers to be promoted and advance in terms of their skills, they tend to be ones that put an emphasis on apprenticeships and kind of pulling people through the workforce pipeline in a very positive way that invests resources. So I definitely support all of those different approaches. look, in these circumstances, we're going to have to think out of the box about what our economy is going to look like on the other side of this pandemic. So in addition to designing that workforce pipeline, when people do get into the jobs, those jobs need to be ones that pay a livable wage, have benefits, and have good workplace protections. And I'm hoping that coming out of this, that'll be a challenge that policymakers like myself, with support and pushing from people in the public like you, that we can really take up that challenge and deliver on a new economy for this country that puts the working person right at the center of our efforts. So thank you for that question. I really appreciate it. Dan, why don't we get to our next caller?
Our next caller this evening is Marty from Columbia. Marty, you're on the line.
Hi. Thank you, Congressman, for taking my call. It's been a while. I've been trying to get in when I can, but I'm just glad I can finally reach you. Is it okay if I comment on the voting and the COVID and the schools before I ask my question?
Sure. Yeah, quickly. Go ahead.
But yeah, sure. I'll be quick. So for me, for the voting, the main concern is one person, one vote. And as long as the voter is legitimate and qualified to vote in elections securely where there's some kind of chain of custody that could be shown, I think that's where you know, the concern is just to make sure that we have one person voting, you know, and one vote counted. For COVID and the schools, so I have two children that go to public schools here in Howard County. So for me, it's about to wear a mask, wash your hands, social distance. You know, I think we've all heard that. But, you know, for the kids in particular, what we found is kids account for only 2% of all the cases. They do not spread the virus well among all people. Adult-to-adult transmission is higher than kids-to-adults or kids-to-kids transmission. So, you know, when the science supports the children, they should go back to school in the fall with some guidelines as far as the social distancing, washing hands, wearing masks as much as possible. So my question is dealing with the sanctuary cities, CHOP zones, Black Lives Matter, Antifa. You know, we watch the TV and we're watching all of these things happen where, you know, people have legitimate grievances, you know, but also at the same time, there's some people, and I'm not sure where they're coming from or why it's happened, but where the cities and the governors and some of the states, they're allowing these mobs to go in and destroy, you know, hurt people, burn the cities, tear down statues. You know, these are not peaceful protesters or assembly. And, you know, I think everybody is looking at TV and they're looking at this and they're like, what has happened to our country? Why is this happening? And why isn't the states and the governors supporting the police? They want to defund the police. And I don't understand that. So my other question is dovetails with that, is with Senator Scott. He came up with a crime bill, and not one Democrat went to work with him on that crime bill. And I'm trying to understand, why can't the senators and the Congress get together and, you know, get your ideas together and have a bill that can pass the House, go to the Senate, pass the Senate, and have the president sign it?
Well, let me talk about that. So you put a lot out there. I appreciate that, Marty. So first on the voting, I agree with you. You want to make sure that the voting is done in a way that we can trust the casting of the ballot and the counting of the ballot. I have high confidence that, for example, voting by mail, where the person has to sign on the outside of the return envelope and that signature has to be matched, is a way of making sure that that vote is being done properly. That's why I'm encouraging people to vote by mail. Like I said, I wish the governor would mail out those ballots to everybody like he did in the primary. Not quite sure why he switched direction on it. In terms of going back to school, I think it's very legitimate on a district-by-district basis for our education officials working with public health officials to try to design the best thing that can allow children to come back. But if there's not a confidence that you can do that, then some of these other measures need to be put in place. And as I said to an earlier caller, I think the education and public health officials at the local level are trying to analyze that and assess it right now. Obviously, those decisions need to be made in the next couple of weeks in terms of meeting parents' expectations and having that guidance set forth. So you as a parent of two people in Howard County public school system, and I'm sure we have many other parents on the call tonight, that's going to be a front and center concern for you. In terms of these protests that have been happening across the country, what's interesting to me is, you know, I attended a number of protests, vigils, gatherings, not too many because I was trying to do it in a sensible and socially distanced way, and in each instance I felt like those guidelines were being followed. But what I encountered was people that aren't looking to tear anything down. They're looking to kind of build up a society that they think is more fair and tolerant and respectful. And many feel disrespected. I think many see this legacy of police brutality, for example, and it causes them deep anguish and pain, and that's what's being expressed. Sure, you're going to get instances across the country where sometimes these peaceful assemblies, in effect, get hijacked and become violent. I don't subscribe to that. I don't think any of my colleagues subscribe to that. And so the key is to try to translate people's hurt and pain and, yes, anger and frustration into something constructive. And when it comes to this notion of defunding the police, I think the better response is, how do we look at police departments and how do we look at public safety and think about new ways of allocating resources so that the police can do their job, so that we make sure that the bad police, the ones who are acting in a violent way, are being dealt with, because if not, then that just hurts the police who are trying to do the right thing, and those are the ones we want to lift up. But how do we also invest in our community and in public safety in some creative ways that respond to concerns and input that we get from the community? I think we can have that conversation, and I think we can have it across party lines. And yes, it is hard these days to get things done on a bipartisan basis in Washington, but I'm going to keep trying to get that done. And, you know, my number one priority at all times is to be listening as carefully as I can to the people in my district. And they all have different perspectives, and I respect that. And I want to try to kind of bring people together on things that make sense. So I appreciate you calling in this evening and sharing your thoughts, along with the others who are participating in our town hall. And if you're just joining us tonight, this is Congressman Sarbanes. We are doing another in our series of telephone town halls, which is a great way for me to talk with folks in my district on any topic. If you want to ask a question tonight, I think we have about 15 minutes left that we can try to get to you. You can press *3 on your telephone keypad, and we'll try to get to you before the end of the call. So, Dan, why don't we get to our next caller?
Our next caller is Chris from Baltimore. Chris, you're on the line.
Hey, Congressman Sarbanes, thank you for taking my call. Just based on the previous comment, I'd like to quickly say that I unequivocally support the defunding and demilitarization of our country's police state, abolition of prison, and its replacement with comprehensive social, economic, and mental health services. My question will take a short bit of background, so please bear with me. The building that I live in is owned by a multimillionaire. He lives in Florida. He's being supported by multiple facets of government relief during COVID, but he's still demanding full rent from us by means of threatening and insulting letters to the tenants in our large apartment building. Essentially, we're being forced to funnel money that is meant for our survival up to people who don't need it, up to companies that don't need it, and to banks that don't need it. Even small landlords, by means of either their choice or mortgage payments, are being forced to collect full rent from tenants. I worked in the event industry for about 10 years. It's in complete free fall. There's no timeline for when it will be able to provide a living wage. And once my PUA is up, my pandemic unemployment assistance as an independent contractor is up, I have no options. I may need to live on the money that I'm receiving right now for an indeterminate amount of time, but instead I'm being forced to use it to pay for rent that could be compassionately canceled by our state and national governments. So my question is, what steps are you taking towards canceling rent and mortgages retroactively for all Marylanders during the COVID pandemic, and when can we expect relief? Thank you.
So, yeah, appreciate that, Chris. All good questions. First of all, I get as angry as you do, and I think many others, when they see that taxpayer money that should be helping the people that are most vulnerable out there during this pandemic crisis is ending up in the hands of people that have plenty of resources and don't require that assistance, and we're trying to chase those situations down as best we can. There's a special subcommittee that we've set up in Congress to try to address that, and they're flushing out some of those folks that have hijacked this relief as it's going out the door. In terms of your particular situation, you said you're in the event industry and you're getting the pandemic unemployment assistance right now, which, as you point out, will be expiring at the end of July. I can tell you what we've tried to do is extend that. And in the HEROES Act, which we passed in the House, but is sitting in the Senate because Mitch McConnell refuses to negotiate on this, we would extend that unemployment assistance. So we've done our part in the House. I certainly voted for that because I know the situation that you're in and that is a lifeline for you. And we pass it in the House. We ask everybody on this call to add their voice to the outcry that says we need to extend that assistance. On rent and mortgage assistance, again, we passed in the House $175 billion. That's $100 billion for rent assistance, $75 billion for mortgage assistance, because we know that there are people in the situations you're describing who cannot afford to pay their rent or their mortgage under these circumstances. That's just the reality of it. And if you don't get that assistance, then you're going to have evictions and other pressure being brought to bear in a way that's totally unfair under these circumstances. So we passed that in the House. Again, it's waiting in the Senate. We hope that the Senate, Mitch McConnell and the Republicans, will respond in the spirit in which we sent that legislation, but they need to do it soon because, as you point out, the timelines are looming here. So I really appreciate you asking that question because on all of those things, I've been very, very focused. Dan, why don't we get to our next caller?
Our next caller this evening is Lori from Columbia. Lori, you're on the line.
Hi, how are you?
Good. Good, Lori.
So just this afternoon, the Washington Post issued an alert saying that tomorrow President Trump is planning to announced some changes to the National Environmental Policy Act. And I apologize, I know you're not on one of the environmental committees in the House, but you're my representative, so I'm going to ask you the question. and while the White House refused to release details ahead of time, what they would say is that they want to reduce the amount of time it takes to get approvals, which basically means they want to do away with some of the protections of the environmental surveys and studies that you have to conduct currently in order to determine how much damage it will do to not only the environment but also neighboring communities, which are frequently lower income communities. Although it doesn't list executive orders, I'm thinking the only way he can do this is via executive order. And what could Congress try to do to limit, removing these protections that are currently in place?
Yeah. Well, Lori, thank you for asking. You're basically pointing to something that's been underway from day one of this administration, and that is to roll back the environmental protections that we need to see enforced in our country. Basically, the Trump administration has gutted the EPA and the protections that we depend on there in terms of clean air and clean water and preserving our natural treasures across the country. Obviously, I am constantly fighting for the Chesapeake Bay in the environmental space. I actually am on the Energy and Commerce Committee, which has a fair amount of jurisdiction with respect to the environment, and I used to serve on the Natural Resources Committee, so I'm very familiar with the issues that you're bringing up. I can say that we just got $90 million for the Chesapeake Bay program in the budget that the House is likely going to pass in the next couple of weeks. The president has almost been trying to zero that budget out for the last few years, so that shows you where his focus is. But basically, he's tried to he's attacked the Endangered Species Act. He's promoted offshore drilling. He's tried to shrink down these national lands and national monuments across the country. What we can do in Congress is oversight, and in the House we have been doing that. In the Energy and Commerce Committee, on the Government Oversight Committee that I sit on, to really ask tough questions and at least expose this to the light of day so that people know what's happening in terms of rolling back these environmental protections. But look, if you care about your kids and your grandkids and that they can drink clean water and they can breathe clean air and they can enjoy the outdoors and that their planet is being preserved, you have to care about these issues, and it's clear that you do. So thank you for your question tonight. I think we have time for maybe a couple more questions. Dan, why don't we get this caller?
Our next caller this evening is Pauline from Baltimore. Pauline, you're on the line.
Good afternoon. First, I want to thank you, Congressman Sarbanes, for holding these town hall meetings and also for the wonderful job that you're doing in Washington to represent us. My question is that I am diabetic, and I have a medication that went from $90 to $400 a month, which is not affordable. All the programs that I have called, I am like $100 over the federal guideline limit. My question is, I've exhausted all the resources. Is there any special resource programs due to the pandemic that will allow us to get that medication? Normally, the doctor or my endocrinologist or my primary will provide me samples, but due to the what's going on with the COVID, they're not able to get anything from the pharmaceutical salesperson. Is there any place I can go to that will help me to get this medication? I can't afford to pay from $90 to $400.
I got you. Please reach out to my office. We will try to connect you to whatever resources there may be. You can call my office during daytime hours, 410-832-8890. You can go to my website. There's a place there where you can submit information and get in contact with us using an email. So I encourage you to go to sarbanes.house.gov. And we can try to see if we can assist you with your particular situation. I can't make any promises, but I can promise you that we will do as much as we can to try to get a good result for you. That's always my commitment. I will say on the broader issue that we have been fighting, and I've certainly been part of leading this charge to address the high cost of prescriptions and medications out there, because we know that so many Americans can't afford it. They can't afford these life-saving medications, and you're an example of that. So we need to do better. We've passed legislation in the House. Again, it's stuck on the Senate side where most of this stuff goes to die right now. But we've passed legislation that would reduce the cost of prescription drugs. The late Elijah Cummings, as you may know, was a big champion of efforts to try to address this concern, and we've certainly picked up the baton from Elijah and tried to carry that effort forward. So thank you for your question. We're coming in towards the end of our call this evening, and I want to thank all of you for participating. I think we've got time at least for one more call, Dan, if not a couple, if I move quickly. So why don't we get to the next caller?
Our next caller this evening is Alan from Howard County. Alan, you're on the line.
Thank you very much, Congressman Sarbanes, for everything that you're doing. And this COVID-19 is one crisis that we've overcome by big action. And the next crisis is still coming, and that is all of those consequences caused by climate change. We need to prepare for that better than we prepared for the virus. Is there anything going on that we can do to move forward to doing whatever we can to prevent the catastrophe that's on the horizon?
Yeah. Well, I appreciate that. Actually, there's a lot of work happening right now. We just had a large 500-page report with all kinds of recommendations that came forward from the Select Committee on Climate Action, which was convened in the House about 6 months ago. And that includes lots of suggestions about how, for example, we can go build a clean, green future, one where our economy can be strong, but we're also respectful of the planet. We in our committee have released a draft of climate legislation called the Clean Future Plan, so that's getting some attention. I really do believe that we can create a future that protects the planet and also lifts us up economically. Those things don't have to be at odds. Too often that's how it's looked at, but if we're smart and creative, we can do both things at the same time. I'm certainly going to continue to try to lead on that because, you know, I know what I want to leave for my kids and my grandkids. I want the Chesapeake Bay to be a place where we're not having sort of, you know, 50, 100 tidal flooding events a year on the banks of the bay and in places like Annapolis. I want to know the water's clean. I want to know that the air is clean. And I want to know that our planet is being protected. This is the only planet we have. I mean, people say that, but it's true. We got to protect and preserve it. So we're not taking our eyes off of that. We'll continue to fight as hard as we can. Even in the midst of this difficult moment, I think we have to keep our eyes focused on the horizon and make sure that it's a clean, green horizon. So thank you for that. Dan, can we get another caller in here before we close up?
That was the last question this evening, Congressman. You can close up.
Okay. Well, I appreciate everybody joining us. For some reason, I just can't get past the 10-question ceiling on these calls. I talk as fast as I can, but I can never break through. So we'll try on the next call, but we did get 10 callers in today. I appreciate everybody participating. As I say, there's no more important resource for me in terms of doing my job than to hear directly from people. And even in times when we weren't forced to be in contact remotely, I found these to be very important ways of communicating, these telephone town halls. But certainly in this moment where we have to social distance, it's one of the few opportunities I have to hear directly and to have a conversation with the people in my district. So I thank all of you for participating. If you have some particular issue you need help with, again, you can call my office during daytime hours at 410-832-8890. You can always come to my website at sarbanes.house.gov. You can sign up for the Sarbanes Standard there. I didn't mention that as much as I usually do on the call tonight, but that's our electronic newsletter. So I encourage you to subscribe to that because we can get you good information. And definitely during this coronavirus outbreak and our efforts to get through it, please view my office, I hope, as a trusted source of guidance and information for you. We've really assembled, I think, some really good information. Dan Jacobs, who was moderating the call today, is the person who's quarterbacked that effort. He's done a terrific job. So please take advantage of those resources. And I think when the call's over, if you want to leave a voicemail, you have an opportunity to do that. We'll try to get back to you and answer any questions that you have. Again, thank you for joining us. We will be doing more of these calls in the future, and we hope to have you participate. Have a great night.